just my woman off when I'm cold. How much did you get your car? Oh, you got it?
Hello. Hi. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Io ho visto la cosa che non mi faccio vedere, adesso sono sotto il telefono.
Did you receive my email with the link? Okay, was all was okay. You can download, take the file.
Okay, but this is not there yet.
No, not.
Okay.
The other guys is arriving, or have you got any information?
He said he's not wandering, so he.
Okay. Okay. And about the other guy, I think from Iran, do you have any information?
No,
okay. But is it in Trieste?
Maybe, I text him, but he didn't reply.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay.
Coordinators? Maybe the coordinators know about him.
Okay. Karim, doesn't have information about him, so okay. I'm going to say that he's not here also today. Okay, the lesson of today, yesterday we have seen the topics of the geodesy, the study of the figure of the Earth and the gravity field. And in the first two lessons we have seen I give you some information about the gravity field of the Earth, the definition and the satellite mission related to the gravity field. At the end of the lesson we have speak about gravity reduction. About the gravity reduction in a very classical way, the standard information about gravity anomaly and so on. Now we have to start with the positioning and the techniques, geodetic techniques to for the definition of the deformation of the crust, to monitor the deformation of the crust from a geophysical point of view. Positioning is a very general topic. We use positioning also for navigation, of course, for a lot of application. We are going to focus our attention in all the geophysical application and that requires most precise accuracy. Before starting this part, so we have seen gravity and we are going to see the geometry definition of the geodesy. Now we had a short lesson on statistics, in statistical estimator. It's important this lesson because when we are going to speak about GPS or INSAR, we are going to use a lot the least square adjustment or least square estimation. So it's important to have to use the same term when I speak about covariance matrix. I want to be sure that you understand what I mean and so on. And this is a very general lesson on this square that you can use in all the application. So, no, sorry, in this part. Okay. It was a very basic lesson with not a rigor. When we start this lesson at the university, I I start with the definition of a random variable, statistical variable, and so on, the definition of probability, and so on. But in this case, I have to reduce a lot the lesson, so we are going to the practical aspect. So, we're supposed to have an experiment. Experiment means every measurement operation. I want to measure the length of this table, I want to measure the dimension of this room, or yes.
The video
on,
sorry.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. Okay. Sorry. Wait. Okay. So, if we have an experiment, the result of our experiment, the measures, can be put in a vector called, in this case, y. And this vector represents a random variable. Okay, so we can use statistics for these values. Often a random variable can be expressed in terms of functional model. For instance, the classical experiment we perform a lot of, sorry, I prefer this one. We did a lot of measure along with the linear, but in the recorder this doesn't compare. No, okay. But I prefer.
No, this is okay.
Okay, okay. The point is, sorry. Okay, so you did a lot of measure, I suppose, over the time. In fact, we use that T. And you can see that this measure has a linear behavior. So we want to fit, interpolate the data with a linear model. This is to find the best representation of this data, but also to predict the values in other time where we don't have measures. And so in this case, we have the vector of the observation can be expressed in terms of parameter A and B, the slope and the interception. And we want to know these two parameters using all the observations. The same when we have a different, for instance, different model of the data. This is a very classical approach. In this case, we have A, B, C as a parameter to represent this curve. Okay, so when the number of observations is greater than the number of unknown parameters, we can use statistical method of estimation. The most used are maximum likelihood estimation or least square estimation. In this lesson, I'm going to speak about least square estimation instead of maximum likelihood estimation, because it's the most used and the most efficient. And so, least square method. I'm going to use a general formulation. Probably you already know which are, if you have to fit the data with a linear model like a line, like a regression line, probably you already know how to compute the coefficient A and B with a closed formula. But I prefer to use a general formula using a matrix notation. So if you remember this notation, you and you understand how to build the metric form of the least square estimation, you can apply this method for every problem, linear and nonlinear. Now we are going to see least square method for a linear problem, but it can be used also in general. So we have a vector of observation, we have a vector of unknown parameters, and the matrix A is called design matrix. And D is a term of non-constant. We are going to see some examples. So in this case, we is the linear functional model. We are speaking about a linear problem. CYY is a stochastic model, and is given by an a priori variance of the observation multiplied for a matrix called cofactor matrix. Sometimes this matrix is called weight matrix. It's called the inverse of the weight matrix. It's like when you compute a mean or a weighted mean. I can give a different weight to my observation. Okay. So this matrix can be also called inverse of the weight matrix. And before to see this, how we can solve this problem means how we can estimate the vector of the unknown parameters given this vector of observation and using this covariant matrix of the observation. Before to do this, we have to define what is a covariant matrix.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Everything in stochastic method are in matrix form? Every term are in matrix form or?
Matrix?
Matrix form?
POM?
Yeah.
POM, I don't know the...
Form.
Form.
Matrix form.
Yes. Yes, yes, every is in matrix. I put underline to say that it is a vector. A Q is a bold to say that it is a matrix.
Okay. And sigma naught square is a variance for that observation. It's a single value.
No.
The a priori variances.
The a priori variance is a constant that is multiplied for the Q cofactor matrix. Is a constant outside the... We are going to explain what is a priori variance. Is a multiply factor of this matrix, but we are going to see what is this, the meaning of this term. So, the expected values of a random variable, we have to define this operator called expectation operator. It's a mean, the weighted average of a random variable. It's a general expression for the mean. So we have this expression is called the mean of y. And it also called the fourth moment of the random variable. This is a vector, of course. And the expected values of the differences between the observation and the mean square is called variance of y. And it's the second moment. We can define the third moment and the end moment. At the moment, we are interested in the first two moments. So this symbol means the mean. It's an operator on our random vector. So the variance, we have seen that this quantity is called variance of y, or second moment. By a practical point of view, we can compute this using this term. The sum of the square differences between the observation and the mean, divided from the number of observation. The square root of the root square of the variance is called standard deviation. Okay, we can also define the covariance. The covariance is given by just a moment. Okay. The covariance is given by this relationship. I'm not sure for the breaks. Okay, just to check this one. Okay, we can use this. In metric notations, the covariance is given by the expected values between the product of the two vectors, given by the difference between the observation minus the mean values, multiplied for the transport matrix. And it's given by this relationship without demonstration. We can see that this is given by the expected values of the product of the observation vector multiplied the transport vector minus the product of the mean transport. This is a general case, so we can, okay. I simplify too much the problem. We can have a one-dimensional random variable or a multivariable with a different dimension. So where we can have a vector of for instance, the measure of the length of this table, or we can compute the covariance between the length of this table and the width of this table. So we have two different random variables, and we can compute the covariance of this random variable. So in statistics, you started to speak about one dimension, and you move to n-dimensional random variable. So this is for this you have the transport of what you see is a scalar in this case. Okay, these are just notation. We are going to see better the meaning. The important thing that the covariant matrix is a positive definite matrix. It means that the product given a vector A in the space Rn, this product is always greater equal to zero. So this is means that the determinant of this covariance matrix is different to zero. And it's important because it means that the covariant matrix are invertible. We are going to see this property is important because in least square we use the inverse of the covariant matrix. So we have to be sure that we can invert this matrix. But by definition of the covariant matrix, we have always a positive definite matrix. So we can invert this matrix without problem, at least apart from numerical problem when you have a very, very big matrix. So, okay, this is what I want to show you. The covariant matrix can written in this form, where along the diagonal we have the variance of the observations. And so the term extra diagonal are the covariance between observation yn and observation m, for instance, 2 and n. And this is a symmetrical matrix. We can write this matrix like a priori variance multiplies the cofactor matrix. What does it mean? It means that it's important, we can extract a multiply factor because and sigma zero quadro, and usually we don't know this term a priori variance, but we are going to see that this is not a problem. Usually in the covariant matrix is important the relative precision between one observation to another observation. Important to see that, for instance, observation y1 is have a double precision with respect to the observation number 2. It's not really important, the absolute values of the measure. When we perform measure, we have seen in, sorry, I skip. Here, for instance, probably we know the precision of this measure. We have information about the precision of the values that we can obtain using an instrument. If I use a rule to measure the length of this table and the rule, we have a tick for every millimeter, I know that the precision should be 1 millimeter or 0.5 millimeter, because I can sometimes interpolate from one tick to another tick. So I know more or less the precision of my instrument and I can guess the precision of my measure. But when often this precision is not realistic, because we don't take into account all the possible source of error. For instance, I don't put the zero line in exact position when I do the measure. My rule can have deformation and so on. So the data are more scattered around the real values. So we have an idea of the precision of the observation, but the exact precision we can be estimated just using a statistic method. So to be sure, I repeat my measure. And after this, computer, for instance, a mean, an average of the data, I can say, okay, the precision is this values. So, to come back in this, is important, this method, the cofactor metric, I can extract a multiplying factor, for instance, also to reduce the numerical problem. If I perform measure with 10 minus 6 meter, this multiplying factor I can remove to have a simple number in my matrix. So this reduces any computational numerical problem in the computation of the result. So this is a covariant matrix.
Sorry.
Yes.
I don't understand how you introduce the dimension. Because sigma naught square is something constant, yeah? Sigma naught square. I don't remember what's the term for.
Okay.
A priori, something variances. That's some one constant, single constant value. Yeah? So if we divide that sigma y1, y2 with some constant value, again it gives this with the same dimension. Okay?
Yes. Yes. Okay. The variance is a number, and the dimension of the number is the physical dimension. The number is the physical dimension of the observation. If we have a length, the variance is a length, a square length. Okay, and given a matrix, I can multiply a matrix for a scalar, or divide all the elements of the matrix by a scalar. Okay, so if you put we are going to see that in the computation, the least square, we use this information. This part will be estimate this, but we use this. So.
Dimension of Q and sigma.
Is the dimension of Q is in a matrix n by n for
the
n.
Dimension of sigma.
Oh, is the same dimension because it's a matrix. Sorry, I don't put the bold.
Okay.
Bold. Sorry, I'm going to check all the notation because I have some doubt. I take my lesson from university, but I use different notation, and yesterday I confused. It's a bold, so it's a matrix as the same dimension of Cn, Cyy.
Okay.
Okay, just another important thing is the variance covariance propagation law. Okay, we have to do. If we have, for instance, a random variable, z and y. I'm going to check. Sorry. Usually I use x and y, but because the notation least square x, y is the observation, x are the parameters, I changed all the notation in this slide except this. This is a z, this is a y. So, we, in a linear case, we supposed to have, for instance, given this table, we want to compute the perimeter of this table. So we know that we have an error for this side, an error for this side, an error for this, an error for the other one. When I combine all this observation to give the perimeter, I have another type of error. The perimeter is not with an error. And this is a linear case. And in a general form, if you know the covariance matrix of the random variable y, we can obtain the covariance matrix of the variable z. And okay, sometimes I use transpose, okay, because it's derived by, is conjugate, okay, but it's not important. And so, given the covariance matrix of y, I can obtain the covariance matrix of z. This is in a linear case. In not in a linear case, when we have a general function, z is a general function of the variable, random variable y, we have to linearize this equation. Linearize is means that we are going to compute a Taylor expansion of this expression and compute this linearization in the mean values, in the mean. At the end, we have obtained now a linear case like this one, but in this case the A matrix became this matrix given by all the derivative.
So it's not exact, yeah? We approximate.
It's approximate, okay. So, so it means that I put the term vector for G because we can have different, for instance, the example of the table. We compute perimeter and area, the surface of the table. So, we have where A is this light side and B is this one. And the area is A multiplied B. Okay, it's very simple. We know the covariance matrix of X, of Y, in this case. So we have the variance of I, the variance of B, and we don't have correlation between this measure and this measure. So we put here zero. Sorry, the term extra, outside the diagonal are the covariances. The covariances give us the relationship. I have to switch, sorry. Ah, okay, it was already blackboard and, okay, I did a mistake. Sorry, it was a mixed record. Okay. The covariance term give us the correlation, information about the correlation between one variable to another one. So if I take my rule and measure this slate, this side, sorry, and the same for the other one, are two independent measures, are not correlated. So we have zero. Okay, if I want to estimate the covariant matrix of PA, we have to propagate this. So, in a general, for this part, it's really simple because
covariance matrix for the between the parameter and area.
Yes, we are going to see that to determine the perimeter and the area, we use the same measure. So the term extra diagonal of this matrix will be different than zero. Okay, so. Because we have a non-linear term, we have to linearize our observation. In the first case, it's really simple because of linearization. And in the second one, I have to... So, this is like our... This term means that we have two different equations, one for the perimeter, one for the area. So it means that we have two different derivatives. So we have to compute. Okay. The term. This matrix is we compute the partial derivative of the first equation with respect to the two parameters and the derivative of the second equation with respect to the second parameter. So. These are the expression of the derivative. As values of B, we put the mean values of B. As values of A, we put so the result of our observation. So we have to multiply this for this matrix and for the transpose of this matrix. Okay. Just to say how we are going to build this matrix. This is in a general case. Given a relationship, I can compute the covariant the propagation of the covariant matrix. Have you got any questions? Probably for you. I don't know what type of math you have done in your course geology. If you have problem, please stop me because I don't know exactly. I know that in physics I think that they don't have a problem with this type of notation, I suppose. But if you have problem, please stop me, of course. Okay, this is to finish the introduction about variance, covariance.
The A, we are not putting B, we are putting the mean value of B instead.
Yes. Okay. In fact, here we have a linearization with respect to the mean values. Okay. No. Why?
Wrong about it.
Okay. Now we start again. No, no, we start again. No, we have introduced what is a covariance matrix, what is a variance of a random variable that is the scattering. Sorry, I forgot to say you, but I suppose that you know is a scattering of the data is the differences between the mean values of our observation. Give us the dispersion of the measures. So, starting from this problem, we have to estimate a vector of unknown parameters given a vector of observation, and we know the covariance matrix of the observation in this form. Okay. The least square principle can estimate this quantity, our measure in terms of parameters, using this principle. We are going to search this vector with these symbols in estimate, the hat. Minimizing this quadratic form, and you can see that in this quadratic form we have the observation, inside this we have the unknown parameter, and we have the stochastic model in terms of cofactor matrix. These are the conditions that our solution have to satisfy. The estimated value, the estimate of y, belong to a manifold of the possible values. Manifold, a variety. Do you know what is a manifold from algebra? For instance, a plane is a manifold, is a variety. Okay, is a linear plane, a linear variety, but we can have also curve variety. Is the set of all the possible values of our observation, and we want that the estimate of the variance is proportional to the minimized quadratic form, to this form. And this is the condition that have to be satisfied by our estimate. But we want okay. And these are the following this condition, we obtain this estimation. It's very hard. Okay. The unknown parameter are given by this matrix product, where we have the transport of the design matrix multiplies the inverse of the cofactor matrix multiplied the design matrix. This product is called normal matrix, indicated with the matrix N. This multiplied for the transpose of the design matrix for the inverse of the cofactor matrix and multiply for the observation minus the known term give us our estimate of the parameter. So to have an estimate of the parameter, we need the design matrix that give us the functional model, the relationship between the parameter and the observation. And we have the cofactor matrix in terms of the stochastic model, sorry, in terms of the cofactor matrix and the observation. So we have our functional model, our stochastic model, and the observation. And this gives us the estimate of the parameters. We want also to estimate the variance, the a posterior variance. Also in this case,
is given by the residual vector, so the observation minus the predicted values using this parameter estimate, and the cofactor matrix divided by the degree of freedom, that is the differences between the number of observations and the number of parameters. We can obtain also the covariance metric of the estimate parameter given by the a posterior variance multiply the inverse of the normal matrix. With this formula we can solve any linear least square problem. Okay, so it's a very general, we don't have just the formula for the coefficient A and B of a regression line. We can fit our data with a different functional model. Okay, yes?
Actually, I don't know. So what is the difference that we already calculated for C-axis and now calculated? What is the difference?
Between this?
C-axis that we already calculated, yeah? And two, I think.
These are before we have seen. This is the covariant matrix of the observation. The other one has the covariant matrix of the parameter. So in a regression line, you have the observation and you have a covariant matrix of this observation. Okay, with the variance of each observation. In the CXX is the covariant matrix of the parameter of A and B. So the dimension is different. So in a regression we have the observation of course depend on the number of observation. Okay, so these are the estimator the formula of the estimator of the parameter and the a posteriori variance. I think that I put sorry, I can understand why it's so high. Okay, the estimator, in general, we want to have an unbiased estimator. Talk about gravity study. Now we started to talk about positioning techniques. That is one of the main topics of space geodesy. And after we are going to see in SARMA next week, at the end of next week. Okay, this first part of the lesson is an introduction lesson. When we speak about positioning, we have to define some quantity, especially a reference system, because we are speaking about coordinates. So we have to define everything. So positioning, the most known techniques are the GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System. The GPS is one of these techniques, but we are going to see that now there are different techniques that use satellite for positioning. And there are other techniques, satellite laser ranging and VLBI. Just we have seen yesterday, the people
solve this problem from the past. We need to know our position. So in the past, we use triangulation to know our position, measure angles and distances between points. But in this case, it was required the line outside. I need to see another point. This is a strong limitation in our measure because the line of sight is confined in some meters or in some kilometers in some case. So in the space geodetic method for positioning, the line of sight is given by the point on the Earth and the celestial object of satellite. Celestial object, because we are going to see that especially these techniques use celestial object, quasar. Okay. So it's a more general is a global positioning system, are valid all over the Earth. So just to give you an idea, in the past the other important difference between the satellite position and the traditional positioning is that with the satellite position we have a 3D positioning. We know the x, y, z coordinate of a point, latitude, longitude of altitude of a point. In the traditional method we separate the altimetric measure by the planimetric measure. With altimetry, with spirit leveling, we compute the differences in the height between points. With theodolite, or now with total station that can measure angles and distances, we obtain the planimetric coordinates of the point. So we have really a separation, and this separation is related to the reference surface. For the altimetry, we have as a reference surface the geoid, because we put this instrument in, we realize an horizontal axis with respect to the gravity field. So we are speaking with respect to the geoid. For the planimetric coordinate, we put our instrument along the vertical and so on, but at the end, to do computation, we use as a reference surface the ellipsoid. So we have in the traditional approach to the positioning, we have also differences in the instrument, but also in the reference surface. With the global navigation satellite system, we have just one reference surface, that is the ellipsoid. And with one instrument, we have a 3D positioning. Of course, it's a 3D positioning with respect to the ellipsoid. To have information with respect to the geoid for the height, do you remember we have to know the geoid undulation, N, capital N. In fact, the problem of the geoid computation was a problem born after the development of the GPS. Okay, before it was a theoretical problem, a geodetic theoretic problem, but okay, we can know the geoid, they can want to know the geoid undulation to do some for geophysical interpretation of the Earth, the like gravity. But with the GPS, the geoid a precise centimetric level geoid knowledge is necessary to convert our ellipsoidal height in orthometric height. So we started really to study how to reach this precision in the determination of the geoid. And this was one of the reasons because we started to have, for instance, the GOES satellite mission to improve the knowledge of the gravity field to arrive to have a better knowledge of the ocean surface, but also of the geoid undulation. This is an important task for the geodetic community. It was my, for the Italian region, was my PhD thesis, was the geoid undulation determination for the Italy. And in the last year, I compute also geoid undulation for other parts of the Earth, just to say, to introduce myself, to say what are my skills. So, okay. We have seen that for positioning we have different techniques, satellite, laser radio, GNS, VLBI. Okay, these are very introductory information. Okay, GNSS, that is probably the most important application. No, it means that satellite, laser radio, VLBI are really very important, these techniques. So I spend some words on to introduce this, because give us so are important to define the reference system, to define where is the geocenter of the Earth, where is the orientation axis of the rotation axis of the Earth, and so on. But the most used in a practical application techniques is the GNSS. The GNSS, the GPS was the first one. It was developed for navigation application. Was a military system by USA, and was created to give the position all over the world. Otherwise, if you go in a country in the past, you have to know you have to have the map of this country to know where you are. So if you have a war, you go in a country and you don't was able to georeference yourself. With a GPS, is an independent system. You satellite, and it was developed to have the position all over the world. It's independent by the knowledge of the reference point of a point of a country, the map of the country, and so on. And with the GNS provide very high temporal resolution measurement. That means that in the past, when I compute the position of a point, I spend a lot of time to do measure of angle, distance, and so on. And it was really expensive to repeat this type of measure. So every 20 years I'm going to repeat the measure to have information about the coordinate of this point to know if this point is under deformation. With the GPS we have a very high temporal resolution. It means that every day we can have a solution. Every day we can know the position of a point, and we can build time series, continuous time series. Okay, we need a break.